I am going to talk about inequalities in health, and there's a book that you can read about where I've summarized much of what I'm going to talk about this evening in relation to obesity. And to set the scene, there for 19 EU member states, ranking by education, we see for women a very clear social gradient in obesity. The lower the education, the higher the obesity. For men, it's in fact getting almost as clear as it is for women. Commonly in the US and the UK, we'd actually seen clear social gradients in obesity for women, less clear for men. I think somehow bulk associated with high socioeconomic position for men was the norm, but that seems to be changing. So we see these social gradients. And the waistline of the planet is expanding. That's global mean BMI for males 1980-2008. Many of you will have seen figures like this. BMI greater than 30, greater than or equal to 30, common definition of obesity. In Egypt, nearly 40% of women are obese. 70% have a BMI greater than 25, and Mexico not far behind. The US figures, these graphs are so shocking. When you first see them, many of you will have seen them, that's obesity by state, and the light color is less than 10%, 10 to 14%. That's 1985, 1997, 2010. Now, if you think that obesity is a matter of personal responsibility, why have Americans become feckless? And they've given up smoking. How come they got responsible in relation to smoking and they got irresponsible in relation to obesity? The whole idea that obesity is simply a matter of personal responsibility is contradicted by the evidence. Is that clear? This is not political prejudice. It's wrong to say it's simply a matter of personal responsibility. It does not explain the social gradient. It does not explain the global epidemic of obesity. And it's been growing. And if you think it's genetic, it's amazing how rapidly the genome can change in the US. Simon said we've got to deal with the obesogenic environment, and we are, Simon, in complete agreement. And this is so ghastly. These are children aged 10 to 11. Index of multiple deprivation from the least deprived to the most deprived. And look, 2006-07 to 2012-13, for the least deprived, it's flat. So you see the gradient for children, the more deprivation, the higher the obesity, but for the least deprived, it's not going up. For the most deprived, it's still going up in this very short period of time. So the inequalities, because obesity tracks through the life course, the inequalities are going to increase. And that will contribute if already you talk about it as the new smoking, and now we see these very clear social gradients in obesity, that will contribute to the social gradient in diabetes, in cardiovascular disease, in cancer, and it's going to get worse. Now, we know that obesity is calories in, calories out. If you don't actually believe the first law of thermodynamics, then I don't know what, read the newspaper for the rest of the afternoon. So we know it's calories in and calories out. That said, how come the balance isn't working? So knowing that it's calories in, calories out only gets us a little bit along the way. Looking at the Whitehall 2 study, the British civil servants, moderate, healthy, unhealthy, and very unhealthy diets, the lower the grade of employment, the more likely were people to be consuming unhealthy diets. We know these are relatively old data, looking at the density of fast food outlets by deprivation of the area. The more deprived the area, the greater the density of fast food outlets, McDonald's, Burger King, and KFC, and Pizza Hut. I'm getting indigestion just talking about. Look at the author of the paper, by the way. Talk about nominative determinism. You know, what will I write a paper on today? But so the density of fast food outlets changes with deprivation. Well, that's right. It's cheap. You can get a lot of calories really cheaply. You can really make your children very fat very cheaply. We've got to deal with it. And it's not simply a matter of being irresponsible. Stress and subordination at work. When I said it's not just calories in and calories out, look at these data from the Whitehall 2 study, looking at job strain, high demand, low control. For people who at baseline had a high BMI, when they're under work stress, they put on weight. Familiar? For people who had a low BMI, when they were under work stress, they lose weight. Familiar? So that the kind of environment in which people are living and working is influencing this balance of calories in, calories in, calories out. And when we look at the metabolic syndrome, central adiposity, high triglyceride, low HDL, high blood pressure, which we think is related to insulin resistance and increases risk of diabetes and cardiovascular disease. We look at job strain, isostrain, which is high demand, low control, and lack of supports. I'm talking about junior doctors now. High demand, low control, and lack of support. And the more occasions in which people reported this job isostrain, the greater the prevalence of the metabolic syndrome. I mean, when you think about this calories in, calories out story, and I'm feeling nervous with Phil James sitting there that I'll say something wrong, but it's absolutely remarkable that we're not having great weight fluctuations week on week, month on month. We're all more or less stable. So it's really a remarkable control system. But people's social and psychosocial circumstances can disrupt that control system, as can sugar-sweetened beverages. They just slip in under the radar. I'll move on. So we're going to tell people that they should behave responsibly. That's our model, isn't it? Simon talked about 20-year gaps in healthy life expectancy. When we published the report of the WHO Commission on Social Determinants of Health, I pointed to a 28-year gap in male life expectancy in Glasgow. 54 years life expectancy for men in Carlton and 82 in Lindsay. I was at a meeting in Brussels and somebody came up to me and said, I live in Lindsay. Well, they don't allow people from Carlton to attend European meetings in Brussels. I live in Lindsay and I drink in the pub, he said, with somebody from Carlton. And the other night I was talking to my friend, it turned out he made no arrangements for a pension. And I said to my friend, he said, why not? He said, because I'm 54. I'm delighted that they're discussing my research findings in pubs in Glasgow and maybe elsewhere. But the idea that this chap had read life expectancy for 54 in Carlton, so he didn't need to make any arrangements for pension. So Jimmy, typical Carlton resident, this case history was brought to me by Detective Chief Superintendent Carnahan, who was responsible for homicide, and famously was asked, would you like another 100 officers on the beat to prevent homicide? He said, no, I'd like 100 health visitors. The way to prevent homicide is good early child development. So Jimmy, single mother, she had a succession of male partners, each of whom abused Jimmy physically, if not sexually. They moved home every year or year and a half. By the time he entered school, he was already labeled as having a behavior problem. He was enrolled in an apprenticeship but dropped out, never had a proper job. Any money he gets goes into drink and drugs. His diet, if you could call it that, pub food, fast food, and alcohol. Here's a thought experiment. Go to Calton and say to Jimmy, I wish I could do a Glaswegian accent, pull your socks up, behave, stop doing drink and drugs, eat sensibly, don't smoke, leave the gangs, put the knife away, get a job, stop abusing your girlfriend, just become a decent individual. You can imagine what the second word of his two-word statement would be, something like off. But you wouldn't get very far with your health education campaign. You want to do something about the growing inequalities in obesity. You've got to do something about the growing social inequalities. This will not be solved by simple health education. 5% of people on low incomes report skipping meals for a whole day. Low income and area deprivation are barriers to purchasing fresh or unfamiliar foods. Look at this. Only 18% of people have one or more meals a day at their table in England. More than 80% of people don't have a meal at table. What does that mean? It's in front of the television. I mean, the idea of what family life is like, the interaction with children is like under those circumstances. But so it's catastrophic for family life, but it's catastrophic for diet because people are eating pre-prepared takeaway meals in front of the television. Nearly two-thirds of people eat at their tables less than once a week. 3% of people have no table. We are not going to solve the obesity problem without solving the inequality problem. And we need action at different stages of the life course. This was our simple conceptual model for the European review of social determinants and the health divide that I led. And I show it briefly because we're talking about life course stages right through the life course, but the wider society, the macro level context and systems. And I'll support what Simon said about the NHS before I finish. Soda market sales forecast by region. Latin America going up very nicely. North America, Western Europe. I looked at the Coca-Cola website. Mexico now ranks number one. 670 8-ounce servings per person per year. That's nearly two a day. If they don't feed it to the babies, I said once, that means the older kids have got to drink three. And I was told, no, they do feed it to the babies. And Mexico has an obesity epidemic and a diabetes epidemic. And Coca-Cola sees it as a marketing opportunity. These were the six recommendations from my English review, Fair Society, Healthy Lives. And we've done some work with Public Health England to show, and I'm not going to go through these, to show for alcohol misuse and obesity and smoking, how we could take the six recommendations and develop policies that Public Health England could try and then see implemented at local level. Give every child the best start in life. I couldn't resist showing you this. If we want children to be educated, if we want them to have better social conditions, we need to acknowledge the fact that among OECD countries, the UNICEF report card, ranking children on material conditions, health, education and behaviours in the early 2000s and the late 2000s. In the early 2000s, we were bottom with the US. We've come bumping up to 16. What on earth are we doing? What on earth are we doing? We will not solve the childhood obesity problem without solving the fact that our children are having a terrible start in life. We rank very lowly. We were an advanced country. We were the most advanced country. And we're failing our children on a grand scale. And I cannot divorce that issue from the obesity issue. I said I would support what Simon said. We produced a report when I spent a year at the BMA as president, which was a very odd thing to happen. I mean, they have real doctors as president of the BMA, like Charles George, and not people like me who say that you've got to change society to improve health. And I thought, well, if I'm there for a year, let's see if we can't get the doctors engaged in the issues of social determinants of health. So we produced this report. Doctors and other healthcare professionals. We got sign up from 21 organizations, the Royal College of Physicians, the Royal College of GPs, the obstetricians and gynecologists, the psychiatrists, all the Royal Colleges except the surgeons. They couldn't see what that had to do with them. The nurses, the physios, health visitors, we've got 21 organizations. And we said there are five areas, and they almost match on to yours, Simon. They're almost the same. We said workforce education and training, working with individuals and communities, the role of the NHS as employer, working in partnership, and advocacy. Health professionals as advocates. So it's nearly an exact mapping on to what you said. Let me finish with this, that when we did our European review, we were dealing with what in WHO terms sportingly is known as Europe, which is the whole of the former Soviet Union, which includes Tajikistan and Uzbekistan and God knows where is Stan. And we said that if you're doing very little on social action on health, do something, it'll make a difference. If you're doing a bit, if you're Poland and the Czech Republic, do more. If you're Sweden and Norway, do it better. My concern is that we were Sweden and Norway, we were doing the best, and we're not anymore. We've got some distance to travel, and we need to do it better. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Michael. A very strong call to action there, so thank you. Our third speaker tonight is Professor Cyrus Cooper, Director of the MRC Lifecourse Epidemiology Unit at the University of Southampton. Now, Cyrus, as you've heard, is Professor at the University of Rheumatology, and he's Vice Dean of the Faculty of Medicine at the University. He's been Director of the MRC Lifecourse Epidemiology Unit since 2003, so I think it's pretty fair to say that he's shaped what it is today. He leads an internationally competitive programme of research into the epidemiology of musculoskeletal disorders and is most notably known, for, I think, for the osteoporosis work, and has worked on numerous Department of Health, European Community and World Health Organization committees and working groups. He's currently chairman of the Committee of the Scientific Advisors of the International Osteoporosis Foundation. So, over to Cyrus. Thank you very much. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Chris. And it's a particular honour for me, actually, to follow Michael's talk. I was a young doctoral student under David Barker in 1988, as we were saying, when he came and gave us a seminar, actually at that time, on the Kuhn-Popper debate at the unit in Southampton. And I remember having a discussion with him about the history and philosophy of science, which has echoes in some of the themes that we're pursuing today in terms of research driving policy. My task is to illustrate for you the contributions that Southampton has made to some of these public health research themes and how those influence policy. And I thought I'd reiterate a point or two on the global burden of disease study that we've contributed to, use two examples demonstrating how discovery public health can lead to alterations in practice and policy. And lastly, to talk about how some of these findings are permeating national, regional, and global policy. And just to summarize in a sentence the work, it's really to point to the fact that it's the generation before and the antenatal developmental exposures that might hold at least part of the key to the reduction in these epidemics of metabolic and musculoskeletal disease that we're considering today. So the Global Burden of Disease pointed out the emergence of metabolic disorders, obesity, type 2 diabetes, to join coronary artery disease and cancer. It also pointed out the explosion in musculoskeletal and psychological morbidity that leads to disability-adjusted life years lost. And those three, musculoskeletal, from body composition, psychological, and adiposity, the accumulation of fat, are linked in a triangulation that goes together, and that we need to consider the reduction in morbidity of collectively rather than separately. The story of the developmental contribution to this emerged through the work of my predecessor as director of the MRC Epidemiology Unit in Southampton, David Barker, shown in the bottom right-hand panel of the slide. David, in the early and mid-1980s, Richard Smith will recall these studies well, many of them were published in the BMJ, looked at the ecological associations between coronary artery death rates today and the mortality of infants some seven decades earlier. He then went on, in the bottom left, to show a replication of a marker of a poor environment, low birth weight, linking to the rates of disease and death from ischemic heart disease in individuals, in that example, in the Hertfordshire cohort study. He coined the notion that there are critical periods of development during which perturbations of structure and function arise, which feed through into increased rates of disease later in the life course. And of course, in that Time cover of 2010, the notion that development contributes to disease during adulthood and that prevention should incorporate measures directed early in life, even during intrauterine and preconceptional periods of life, is now considered the norm rather than the outlier in preventive strategies. And the work that we've done takes this both etiologically and in preventive terms a step further. We aim to understand how a young woman's diet and body composition, through epigenetic processes at plastic periods of development during intrauterine and early postnatal life, set up the trajectory that we've heard about during infancy, childhood, and subsequent adult life, and that vulnerability to disease. And of course, if we can intervene during early periods, smaller effect gains can translate during tracked phenomena to larger interventions. And particularly, intervention during the plastic early phase can make a substantial, can have a substantial effect on disease reduction once there's a failure of response to later environmental challenge. Musculoskeletal aging, a very quick sojourn through a 25-year story. In the late 80s and early 90s, the WHO facilitated us in defining the disorder osteoporosis. Looking around this room, unlike my undergraduate students, you have all sadly reached your peak bone mass a long time ago. You're on the rate of decline, which will vary with about 50% from peak and 50% from loss rate to that picture on the right, which is where you're at increased risk of fracture. And those fractures occur at a frequency of about 1 in 2 women from age 50 onwards through the rest of their life, and 1 in 5 men. And they principally occur at the hip, the spine, and the distal forearm. And they have substantial costs, £3.1 billion a year in this country, €39 billion throughout Europe. Does early growth mark out an increased risk of osteoporosis? Well, that can be studied in cohorts of individuals such as those in Hertfordshire, where birth weight and weight in infancy have been recorded during the period of the 1920s and 30s, and people have been followed up at the present time and assessed for their risk of disease. And those studies show very clearly that that marker of a poor environment, low birth weight, is associated with low bone mass in adult life. And that is after you adjust for the lifestyle characteristics such as diet and exercise, smoking and alcohol consumption that modulate bone mass in the loss phase in later life. Next point, this is because genes define both birth weight and later bone mass. Except that we now know from genome-wide studies the genetic determinants of birth weight and the genetic determinants of bone mass. And we can study those in monozygous twins, and we find that they actually fail to account for that relationship. And lastly, we can link these perturbations of growth directly to fracture using other cohorts. For example, this cohort in Finland, where you can see that as you move down the distribution of childhood growth, you get an elevated risk of fracture, and the constellation that leads to fracture is tall mother, poor growth in utero, small baby, and poor growth in childhood. What about modifying that observational data? For that, one can utilize mother-offspring cohort studies. 12,500 non-pregnant Southampton women, the Southampton Women's Survey, recruited aged 20 to 34 years. You wait 6 years for 3,100 of them to become pregnant. You study the pregnancies through their course, and we now have followed the children up to their 10th year of postnatal life. And you characterize the correlates of poor bone development. These are shown here. If the mother smokes, if the mother has very high physical activity in late pregnancy, if the mother has poor nutrition during pre-pregnant phases of life and during pregnancy, these have infants with low bone mass. But the most important that we have found in our studies of the determinants has been the mother's vitamin D status. And observationally, the mum with a low vitamin D before and during pregnancy has a child who has lower bone mass at birth and which remains on a lower trajectory of skeletal development through its childhood and in the observational data as far as age 21. And so we've just completed a study looking at the effects of pregnancy vitamin D supplementation. We randomized mothers at 11 weeks of pregnancy to either a vitamin D supplement of 1,000 units daily or placebo, and the principal outcome measure is the bone mass of the child. And these data will be out in the Lancet Diabetes and Endocrinology journal in the next 4 or 5 weeks. That vitamin D supplement, an example of a single micronutrient supplement intervention, leads to correction of vitamin D insufficiency in over 80% of the pregnant women. It has a striking seasonal difference in its effectiveness. For births in winter, which are shown in the left-hand panel, the supplement highly significantly improves the bone mass of the offspring. But for births in summer, spring and autumn, that effect is not observed. And if you look at what happens to the vitamin D levels in the placebo on the left and the treated on the right, the effect that the supplement has for the birth that for the birth in winter, i.e. the pregnancy that starts in the summer, is to eliminate the decline that you can see in the left-hand graph and convert it to a horizontal or slight increase. So it's the decline that's eliminated by the supplement, and that is what translates into the improvement in the baby's bone mass. And the point for you is that this simply joins a life course approach to the prevention of fracture that continues through childhood, the early postmenopausal years, later life, and even the period of institutional care. Why are these developmental mechanisms there? The science that we have at our disposal now allows us to explore how the sentient developing organism responds to maternal environment through altering the switching on and off of genes by attaching methyl groups to key areas of their promoters. And by studying this DNA methylation phenomenon, you can link the mother's nutritional status to the development of her offspring's skeleton. And this is a ubiquitous mechanism in biology. For example, if you take bee larvae that are genetically identical and feed them royal jelly for 3 or 6 days, you flick a developmental switch through this methylation system to becoming either a queen or a worker. And there are many examples of this that there isn't time to go into today. The second example leads to individualized behavior change and system change as the key drivers, rather than some medicalized magic bullet. And it's the example of childhood obesity. Michael has illustrated this cycle from poor start in life going on to capacity to parent that cycles into childhood and subsequently adult obesity. Our data have reproduced the observations that poor educational attainment was the single greatest determinant of the choice of dietary pattern of women of childbearing age. And this goes on into the way in which they feed their infants and their subsequent infants as they grow into children. How are those choices made? They are dependent on a series of perceptions of self-efficacy and control, as well as on food insecurity, the fiscal backdrop, and social support. These psychological studies have led to the development of a behavior change intervention that can be targeted in this study that was undertaken through the unit at women in children's centers, the old Sure Start centers. Sessions of healthy conversation skills, peer-led, to attempt to improve self-efficacy, to improve sense of control, and hopefully to improve diet. The first of these objectives, the self-efficacy and control, were clearly met. The diet needs further work, and that's the current subject of those studies. But in addition to those more individualized regimens, we also need attention to the food environment. For example, how do we use natural experiments of where stores present food in different ways, as we're doing in one of our studies, to look at how psychology intervenes in the individual and dietary behavior becomes the outcome? That is the challenge for the food environment that we face. So in closing, globally, this has been an open door. In October of last year, I addressed a European ministerial conference of the WHO, at which they unanimously voted through a declaration on minimizing childhood exposure to poverty and health inequalities, recognizing education as a major social determinant of health, and this panoply of measures which they wish to espouse through the assembly next year for the life course approach in the context of the Sustainable Development Goals and Health 2020. the WHO in Geneva have just, through Mark Hansen and Peter Gluckman, concluded their report on the Commission for the Ending of Childhood Obesity, which again promotes the intake of healthy foods, physical activity, preconceptional and pregnancy care, early childhood diet and physical activity, and healthy nutrition and physical activity at school, echoing this early phase intervention to retard the later epidemic of metabolic syndrome and cardiovascular disease. And in our own Health of the Nation report from Sally Davies, we have a chapter on preconception health that translates this to the spheres of Public Health England and NHS England. So our own unit continues. We were fortunate enough to be resupported till 2020. We will continue the work on mechanisms and interventions, and I hope that I'll be able to show you in at least 5 years' time that perhaps we're beginning to turn the corner on this epidemic of non-communicable disease that has such great morbidity and mortality associated with it throughout the life course. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Cyrus. We'll now move to the panel discussion part. So just let me start by introducing Professor Ian Cameron, Dean of Medicine at the University of Southampton, to this stage of the process. And Ian's going to introduce the panel and then chair the discussion that follows. So thank you.
So thank you, Chris. So before we move on to the panel discussion, you've met three of the panellists, but you've not met the other two. So I'm going to give them both a bit of a chance to say a little bit about who they are and where they're coming from in terms of their research to put things in context. So you've got to keep it brief so we have a decent discussion. First one is Paul Roderick.
So thank you, Ian. And it's a great privilege to have the opportunity to follow three such distinguished speakers. I could say to Simon, we've got rid of Burger King in Southampton, so we are making progress. I spent half my adult life course using Michael Marmot's slides to teach the students, so it's great to hear the social inequalities and also observing the great research in the MRC. So I just wanted to, rather than say about my own research, just sketch out the architecture and structure of research in public health research in Southampton, which came out as our constructed a bid to the NIHR School of Public Health call at the end of last year, and just to show you the opportunities we have in Southampton to really take forward public health research. So this complex diagram locates the MRC over here, and we have a spectrum of research from experimental medicine through to the population perspective going across here, from discovery to implementation. So we have not only the MRC, we have a round table of NIHR units coming together as one Wessex NIHR. I'll highlight the BRC in Nutrition and Respiratory Clinical Trials Unit. And over here we have the Wessex AHSN and Wessex CLAHRC, and Anne is going to mention a little bit more about the CLAHRC. My colleagues and my own unit in primary care, Paul Little and Mike more particularly, have been instrumental in tackling antibiotic resistance, so real strength in attacking that public health problem. We have really good links with Health Education Wessex and the workforce development, particularly for public health practitioners. My colleague Julie Parks is head of the public health in the deanery there. We have the strength of the Wessex Institute, bringing research management, now the National Dissemination Centre, and health technology assessment. And then down here, they've just brought in the National Involved Programme, the PPI, to contribute that aspect of research. And over here, the population perspective, I've got a little arrow to the table. If we could get into the National School of Public Health, that would be great, though it's a tall hurdle. But has catalysed join up with PHE. And it's great that Angela Baker's here. We've got an agreement for a joint consultant post in health improvement starting in April. And also David Phillips here is an experienced academic and DPH in Dorset, who's also going to second himself to the University of Southampton to help us with our research. So real opportunities in the architecture. In our structure of our public health approach, you see the life course, the start well, stay well, age well, that Cyrus and Mike, Michael have illustrated with this feedback loop of preconception, what we do as adults, feedback into the cycle. I just wanted to point this right-hand side. We have a very strong tradition in Southampton of interdisciplinary research. We've had a cross-faculty public health group for the last 5 years. In our bid to the NIHR, we involve 6 faculties across the university, and we can draw on some great distinctive disciplines. Implementation science, Carl May. Web science, Southampton was the home of the World Wide Web. And the use of big data, particularly locally, we have a very good integrated health record that Simon will be interested in, the Hampshire Health Record, and how we use that to inform the healthcare process. Health psychology, Lucy Yardley's been doing some great work on digital interventions using websites and apps, most recently with my primary care colleagues on the power study looking at adult obesity. Of course, we have strength in epidemiology and statistics. Cyrus has highlighted about the effect of place. It's very strong health geographers, Graham Moon and colleagues. Distinctive strengths in public health ethics and law with John Coggan, and health economics and modelling. And that helps us contribute to the research around the life course. We've got also particular techniques, social network building, which Anne Rogers is going to talk about. And we're trying to think about how we develop systems thinking in terms of public health interventions, with David joining us and Carl May trying to move that forward this year. We're aware of the different settings that we can operate. I'm not going to go through them all, but I just highlight school-based interventions. We've heard about the Life Lab bringing school-aged children into the academic health setting to teach them. We've also been working with our School of Education to train new teachers in the health of children, which is quite an innovative program, the only university that's doing that with their trainee teachers. We've got real strengths in occupational health, and I know we're trying to make Southampton Hospital a healthy hospital. And we're trying to use the big data to inform our healthcare program. For example, evaluating the NHS health checks in the Hampshire area and other natural experiments. I'll just highlight one of my own interests in the alcohol pathway. Alcohol clearly topical with the CMO's new guidance. The only chronic disease where age-specific rates are rising in terms of mortality. So very fortunate we have very good clinical engagement. Colleagues such as Nick Sharon, Richard Aspinall engaged in thinking about the whole pathway to alcoholic liver disease. So here's the pathway through drinking too much, getting early liver disease and severe liver disease. So what are we doing? We're trying to think of how we can assess and intervene with brief interventions across the system. It's not only in GP care, trying to do that in sexual health settings with a large alcohol problem related to sexual health presentations, in community pharmacies. We're trying to evaluate the reducing strength initiative. We haven't got minimum unit pricing at the moment, but if you take off the very strong drinks with over 6.5% off the shelves, which is particularly the white ciders, which some of our most dependent drinkers are drinking, and ports have been doing that, it is like minimum unit pricing. So we're trying to work with them to evaluate the effect for that program. In primary care, early detection liver disease, so with Nick Sharon, early screening in high-risk groups with non-invasive markers, and then intervening to stop this pathway to severe liver disease. Severe alcoholic liver disease, which is asymptomatic and people turning up and then dying. And so with the AHSN and CLAHRC, we're also looking to improve the care pathway in hospitals of people with severe liver disease, and we're evaluating a detoxification and recovery pathway as part of the CLAHRC. And I'll just flag up one drink you can probably drink more of, we hope, other than just water, coffee. So we've just produced a systematic review that shows that the more coffee you drink, it seems to protect against liver disease. It also protects against diabetes. So we're trying to think about an intervention program in high-risk groups to prevent not only liver disease, but diabetes. So enjoy your coffees afterwards. I'll just end with health inequities. I would have to, having heard Michael. So we're doing work on fuel poverty. There are 2.5 million homes that are fuel poor. With Southampton, the British Gas Initiative, we're trying to understand the health needs of community offenders. So if we have more prison reform, there might be even more of them, but they're a troubled group, as Michael has shown, from Scotland, with heavy alcohol, drug and mental health problems. And across the university, with our previous Vice Chancellor, I think there is an interest in health literacy, digital literacy and health numeracy, and we're trying to understand that better. Not only its determinants, how to improve it and address its contribution to health inequalities. So I'm going to end there. I think there is a great infrastructure for public health research in Southampton, and the commitment and the people are really looking forward to working to tackle some of these huge public health challenges. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Paul. It's good to see there's an evidence base for the new coffee outlet at the front of the University Hospital. The final panellist is going to be Anne Rogers. Again, and come and say a little bit about who you are and what you're doing.
Well, you took my line away about saying supporting Costa Coffee at the University of Southampton. I'm Anne Rogers, and I work very closely with the CLAHRC Wessex, one of 13 of the Collaboration for Leadership in Applied Healthcare Research in Wessex. And the CLAHRCs are actually established to focus on partnership between the NHS and other community partners, focusing on chronic disease and public health interventions. And we have a number of areas of work around health inequalities and public health. We have hospital mealtime assistants and volunteers looking how to construct a workforce for better nutrition for older people, work on antibiotic prescribing reduction, and a whole range of other things. Now, my own personal interest, however, is on public health interventions as it relates to the capacity of patients, public and voluntary and third sector involvement as a kind of workforce, and a workforce that works really in relation to social networks. And this actually came really stemming from previous work I was involved with in evaluating the expert patient program. A very good programme focusing for the first time on self-management support for people with a long-term condition. But one of the things that became evident was that individual appeals for people to actually focus on self-efficacy to change their behaviour really wasn't actually helping as much as one predicted that it might. And there's also a whole range of evidence about the power of social networks and the connections that people have with one another and the ability to mobilise resources through social networks, which is something that we should really be focusing on, and that sort of came out of that earlier work. And I can top everybody with this idea about isolated people with a long-term condition have poorer health outcomes. And actually, isolation is more damaging for your health than taking no physical activity, and it's twice as harmful as obesity. So this issue about isolated people and the needing to connect people up and engage people is really very serious. So really, we're looking at Southampton and how social networks can enable people to mobilise their resources for managing a long-term condition. And we've shown previously with our research that it can support wider self-management efforts. And it actually is the support from a network in terms of social involvement can actually save the NHS money, because there's a link between the collective efficacy that people have through connecting up and their own self-efficacy. And out of the groups that are more socially involved, they actually utilise services less than people who aren't. So if we're looking for that connection between more appropriate use, we should also look for social networks. And so here really is something, of course, Simon Stevens will know about this triangle. I think that's sort of it came from group health and was adopted a lot by the NHS. But we've modified it to show really the workforce that we're talking about here. And that is a very small section to do with health systems and health professionals in helping people to take preventative action around lifestyles. But there are a lot of people that people are connected with. There are people with long-term conditionals, personal communities, voluntary and community groups, non-health professionals. And the main arena for working with people is their everyday lives. And so that obviously health professionals are more orientated towards morbidity. That's their focus, illness focus. And most people in making lifestyle changes and connecting up focus on their everyday lives. And does it fit with that? And I'm going to mention football because the fitness fans in training has shown that, you know, if you want to really become attractive for middle-aged men who are overweight, you get to them through their interest in football. And there's a lovely paper in The Lancet that shows that that is the way we should be engaging people. So looking outside the formal healthcare system to this larger workforce and different types of settings and through social networks is where we're focused our work on. And just to mention the genie, which we're using in NIHR CLAHRC Wessex, is a tool really to look at the way in which people can actually map and reflect on their networks of support and the connections they already have, and perhaps some of the gaps that they might have in their networks, which could, if they had it, enable them to connect up to resources that might be helpful. And so we have a network mapping tool that connects people, and we ask people about their preferences, and then we try to connect them up to resources they are in the community. So why should this work? I just want to finish on this, of the way in which we think this tool is working. We think the raising of awareness of social networks is very important, because we can engage patients in reflecting on their needs and support without becoming very victim-blaming and reflecting back on themselves all the time, which often isn't very useful. And it can help them access further resources and knowledge for illness management and behaviour change, as well as strengthening existing individual and community networks. And so we're trying to implement this and evaluate Genie in a range of formal and informal healthcare settings. At the moment, it's fully integrated into the new Vanguard on the Isle of Wight. We're using it in as far away as Canada, and we're trying to use it in relation to patients with COPD, moving people on from maintenance clinics to accessing resources in the community, and a range of other settings. So I just wanted to say that I think one of the missing elements is how we make connections and how we use social networks in order to promote better health and better long-term condition management. So thank you very much.
So thank you, Anne. So could I invite all of the five panellists up to the stage now, please? We've got about half an hour for discussion. There are two roving microphones, so please, if you wish to ask a question, please make sure you use one of the mics. Well, we're starting the front left-hand side here, Chris Edwards.
Thanks. Well, thank you very much to the panel for some excellent talks. I wanted to ask a rather specific question. We've heard an awful lot about early life events, and they're very important. But as Hank Cyrus was mentioning, most of us are past our peak bone density, and I think most of us are more concerned perhaps about our cognitive performance. So I just wanted to ask a little bit about the question of dementia and cognitive impairment, because what's fascinating to me, and obviously we're faced in this country at the moment with life expectancy being going up by 5 hours per day, which is really quite a lot, and it's going to produce clearly an enormous burden on the NHS. And there's a study which I don't know how well known it is, but it's the so-called VitaCog study, which is principally Oxford-based, where what they did was to take just over 200 people, give them replacement therapy with B6, B12 folic acid, follow them over 2 years, looking at their MRI scans and, in fact, their cognitive performance, and showed a very highly significant difference between the treated and the untreated groups. Now, they have completely failed to get further funding. They wanted to do 1,200. It's going to cost about £5 million. And they've applied to five separate groups and have failed to get that funded. Now, part of this, of course, is that no actual drug is coming out of this, and no drug company is going to make profits out of it. But to me, the data is extraordinary, and I just wondered if the panel might like to comment and to say, is this something that we ought to be looking into a little bit rather more?
Thank you. So who'd like to pick that up?
Well, not surprisingly, if you look at cognitive dysfunction, it shows a remarkable social gradient. If you look at numerical skills, memory, other cognitive measures, in our studies, people of high status reach this decline to the same level about 15 years later as people of low status. So in terms of cognitive function, if you're better off to be educated than to be young. Now, that might be, regrettably, the rate of decline seems to be parallel in the different status groups. So we're all heading for Gaga land, but if you're high status to begin with, you had much higher function. So you get down to that dysfunctional level much later.
Michael, that's fine. I'm just going to say, this is some evidence you could actually potentially do something.
Yeah, well, that was the next thing, that people are, researchers in this are totally bipolar between use it or lose it, or lose it or use it. Do you stop doing the Sudoku because you can't do it any longer, or if you stop doing the Sudoku, you won't be able to do it any longer? I'm biased, So I look at the papers in the New England Journal of Medicine that show that involvement in physical activity and cognitive activities actually delay cognitive decline. That doesn't mean that the other things you're talking about won't be important as well. But what it does suggest is it's not a sentence that's irreversible. There are things we can do about it.
It's weird to get Simon to say, to me, this is an area of incredible importance to the NHS. And really, if we have a situation where we cannot invest in that, is it because effectively, it's a little bit more like the point Simon made in his speech. He said, if the New England Medicine had been a drug, it would have been much easier because obviously it would have been pushed. And all I'm saying is, it's rather worrying if something which could in fact actually be very simply, very easily, and very quickly and cheaply done, apparently we're not willing to actually to look at it.
Does anyone else wish to? Cyrus?
I would endorse the point that Michael made about physical inactivity, that of the determinants of cognitive decline that there are, and of the overlap between cognitive decline, CNS function decline, and musculoskeletal or physical functional decline, which there is a substantial correlation between, it's sort of aerobic physical activity seems to be an important part of that linkage. So that's the first. The second, though, is to say that although this is not a pharmaceutical and therefore a corporate partner is not going to be there in the way that it might be if it was some new monoclonal antibody, I personally think that the systems for funding that type of research for nutritional interventions are available on both the NIHR and MRC sides, and I would have thought that the EME program, the HTA program that are run by the National Institutes of Health Research and the MRC's comparable discovery science programs sort of do provide an avenue where I wouldn't have said that it was impossible for a research question to be addressed of that type. Now, whether that specific one should or shouldn't be, I'm afraid I just don't know enough about it.
We probably should move on to another question, I think. There's one here.
Thank you. What do the panel think about portion sizes?
Too big.
Smaller plates.
The evidence is clear. Smaller plates and portion size reduction. That's part of why we've seen the increased calorific intake and the energy imbalance that Michael talked about. It's happened over the course of two decades, and we've got to reverse it. But we've got to kid ourselves while we do so.
And we've got the wrong economic incentives, that you get a pizza that's this size, and for only a little bit more, you could get a pizza that's that size. You go into one of the 97 coffee outlets on Tottenham Court Road, and we've calculated the cost per calorie of the, whatever they call it, the big one, which is the small one, and the simply ginormous one, which is
Michael's alternative career in pizza marketing is yet to take off.
This is coffee now. Right. I switch from pizza to coffee. And the cost per calorie is half for the ginormous one than it is for the simply too big one. So the economic incentive to overconsume is there. We've got perverse economic incentives, and that can only come with some form of regulation.
Which is why, by the way, we shouldn't be too complacent about coffee in the various forms that it's served up to us in some of the well-known national and international chains, because one in particular is serving a popular size of coffee type product that has the equivalent of 20 spoons of sugar in it. If we knew that, we might choose differently.
There's a question over here, please. I thought you had two microphones.
My name is Tahan. I'm a public health consultant from London Borough of Enfield, and my question is directed to Sir Michael and Stephen. And it's not an academic question. And after the next 2 years, and public health funding will stop, and local governments will have to fund it through business rates and among many others. And what do you think its implication and on health inequalities, and also what will be its impact, do you think, on the residents of local authorities, which are not having a large revenue? Thank you.
Well, certainly, one of the encouraging responses to my English review was the uptake from local government. Have been very encouraging. Three quarters of local authorities claim to have Marmot implementation plans. But I think closing Sure Start children's centres is a very bad idea. So it turns out, as David Cameron's auntie, as I read this morning,
and mother apparently,
Mr. Cameron doesn't quite know what the effect of his cuts are on his own local authority, which is a pity. But closing Sure Start children's centres is a very bad idea. Margaret Whitehead plotted the decline in funding to local government against mortality. The higher the mortality of a local authority, the greater the drop in government funding. Now, we know that that maps onto deprivation. So the more deprived the local authority, the steeper the decline in funding to local government. That can only make health inequalities worse. That's a terrible thing to do.
Simon, did you want to pick up?
No, I think that's right. I mean, I think I've sort of publicly said that I think unresolved business around local government financing, in particular the connection with social care and indeed public health services that are now funded out of local government. I got myself into slightly hot water by saying that I can see the in principle argument for having public health functions embedded in local authorities, but choosing to do so at precisely the moment local authorities are subject to such substantial budget pressures, you know, may not have been the best of moments. But you know, I know there's sort of contrary views to that, but I think the important point going forward anyway, I'm sure there are efficiencies that can be made in those parts of spending programs, just as there are everything else, but frankly I think we've got to keep a very eagle eye on the availability of the preventive services and public health services that are being delivered out of that part of the equation, because if we don't, then certainly on things like drug and alcohol services, sexual health services, I mean, that will just show up as perfectly predictable inflows of patients needing treatment to the National Health Service, and we would have been penny wise, pound foolish.
Thank you.
My question is for Michael as well. I mean, we've known about health inequalities for a very, very long time, but we don't seem to have made much progress. Why have we done so badly? And specifically, have you evaluated the report you did with the BMA? Did that have much effect?
Why have we done so badly? Let me just take two indicators. The first is income inequality, and I'm not of the school that thinks the Gini coefficient has got some mechanical relation with health inequality. But I do think the general inequalities in society do have something to do with it. And if you look at the share of total household income enjoyed by the top 20% and the bottom 20%, it went up very steeply in 1979. It was Mrs. Thatcher's policy to do that. The share that the top 20% had went from about 37% to about 42 or 43%, which is huge. And then stayed there. Thatcher, Major, Blair, what's his name, the one that came after? It stayed there, didn't make any difference at all. And the bottom 20% went from about 9% of total income to 6% and stayed there. So we didn't actually address the real inequalities in society. The tax rates at the top, this has been Tony Atkinson's recent book, shows that the US and the UK stand out among the rich countries of having been a wonderful deal for the top earners, that their effective tax rate is low, their share of total income has risen, And it's not an inevitable part of an industrialised country, because it didn't happen in Germany, and it didn't happen in the Netherlands, and it didn't happen in the Nordic countries. So we've participated through 30 years. I mean, I was in Wales yesterday, and the minister there is just terrific. He's an, my prejudice, he's an academic who speaks knowledgeably about the data, and he says the level of inequality that we've had over the last 30 years is unprecedented, and we made no dent on it. And then look at the table I slipped up very quickly on early childhood and the social gradient in early child development and the social gradient in education. We know in a country like Finland, you can reduce the inequalities in education. They did it, and we've chosen not to do it. We haven't done it. And I could go on, I could talk about work, and I could talk about the... So when you say we've known about it for a very long time, yeah, but we haven't done very much. Now, I am, as a BBC interviewer said to me, a professional optimist, but I would claim I'm an evidence-based optimist. And I'm excited by the fact that local government has been taking on my report in England. I'm excited by the fact that a number of countries are taking it on. I'm trying to figure out getting back from Tashkent to go and address the Swedish government at a weekend retreat, if I can do that, because they're all excited about this. And when it comes to, are the doctors taking it on, Lord Lowe had a low commission. Some of us think there should be a high commission, but never mind. Had a low commission. And he looked at the evidence of what can be done in primary care addressing wider determinants. And it's really quite an impressive report that he produced at the end of last year with good examples. Whether it was due to my BMA report or anything, who knows, and I don't really care. I just care that it's happening. And it's not just Bromley by Bow. There are other parts of the country where social prescribing is happening, where primary care particularly, it's part of Simon's new model of primary care, and we're working with NHS England in the vanguard areas, trying to make it real. And I'm excited. You know, I don't say if 1% are doing it, 99% aren't. I say 1% are doing it. Wow, that shows it's possible.
As you said, you were the optimist. We've got a question over on the left here.
Thank you very much. Sam Crow from Public Health Dorset. It's a quick question to Simon. I enjoyed your talk immensely, and I think the five things that you mentioned for the NHS to focus on are absolutely right. I don't mean this to sound too challenging, but having worked in public health in both cultures, the NHS and also local authority, I fear that the level of cultural change required in the NHS to achieve those five things is so huge at a time of intense pressure and demand. I'd just be interested in your views about how you're going to achieve that level of cultural change, because we know quite a lot of the technical things that are required to make improvements in public health. It's never about the technical side. It's all about culture and behaviour. So I just wondered if you could comment on that, please.
Yeah, no, you put your finger on the sort of key challenge, which is that right now people are facing up to some kind of real kind of here and now issues around their, you know, hospital finances, around kind of the operational performance of the National Health Service, getting to the end of the year, planning for next year. Overlaid on that, however, what we've said is that we believe that we're not going to be able to put the NHS as the NHS on a sustainable footing for the next 5 years unless in each part of the country we come together over the next 6 months and beyond to try and create place-based approaches to health improvement as well as care redesign, and trying to kick off that process so all of the players in what are going to be around about 40 to 45 geographies that people have identified as what counts as their version of the board they want to play on, that has got to answer those questions, because we can't buy our way out of the status quo on the current model we've got. And I mean, I just illustrate this with one very simple point, and I think actually some of this research on bariatric surgery has been done at the University of Southampton, so if anybody is a bariatric surgeon in the audience, you'll forgive me for taking a pop, but I'm about to, which is that there was a piece of research published in, I think it was either PLOS Medicine or PLOS One, just before Christmas, something like, I don't know, December 23rd or something, I'm sure you're reading your medical journals on December 23rd. Anyway, basically the proposition was 1.4 million people overweight in this country might benefit from bariatric surgery, compared with the 6,000 people a year who are currently getting it. And at the prices, even if there were the kind of, you know, surgeons and all the rest of it to do the surgery, which of course there aren't, the prices that it would cost, 1.4 million weight loss operations would cost us £8.4 billion. Which, for those of you who study the Treasury's output, you will know that £8.4 billion is precisely the amount of extra money the National Health Service will have each year by 2020. So we can spend it all on bariatric surgery, or we can get serious about the agenda you've described. So when you're having that conversation with your colleagues in Dorset, I hope you will work out what is your share of 1.4 million bariatric operations and get them to focus that way, if no other reason.
I just wanted to add another evidence-based comment to Richard Smith's question. Three of the Royal Colleges, the Royal College of Psychiatrists produced a report, Mental Health, Public Health. Now, that was really based on the Marmot review rather than the BME report. The Royal College of Paediatrics and Child Health, they said this is their new agenda. Royal College of Obstetricians and Gynecologists. Now, that was really surprising to me. They, while I was at BME, I engaged with them. They said, come along and talk to our council. So I did. I said, your mission is to get a healthy baby out and have the mother go home alive and healthy. Do you care what happens after the baby goes home? That baby is going to become a parent, a dad or a mum, and the quality, etc., through the life course. And I really laid it on thick. 3 months later, they invited me back for breakfast. And they said, we've been thinking about it. And we think we need to rethink our training of specialists. We should be the advocates for women's health through the life course. Mm. Wow, that was terrific. Best breakfast I ever had.
Yeah. So evidence can work then. So question at the back there. No.
Thank you. Thank you to all of the panel for some very interesting evidence base. And it's very apparent that we have quite a lot of evidence for what we should be doing and even for how we should do it. But I'm still slightly anxious that this is not actually getting into place. And even with Simon's five areas that need to be addressed within the NHS, it does seem to me, I think one of the other questions already picked on this, there is a real mindset change that needs to be brought about within the NHS. I mean, I'm in the cognitive group in the room that's actually old enough to remember the Wanless report, which I think spelled out very clearly the model of the NHS, even those many years ago, was not going to achieve what it was going to achieve without a more preventive focus. And I just wonder really how the panel, as individuals and collectively, think that that's actually going to be achieved over quite a short time period, when there's been endeavours to do so over quite a long period, which haven't made enough inroads. And in fact, Michael Marmot is showing that the UK is going backwards, not forwards.
So would anyone like to pick that up?
Yeah. Well, go ahead.
I would agree with you. I think there's only limited answer to the NHS providing the support for these types of things. I do think the capacity of voluntary organisations and new roles that are operating outside in terms of care navigators or lay health trainers or sports specialists or other people that actually aren't trained health professionals have got a much bigger role, and that we should be focusing on trying to engage and leverage and support those organisations in order for them to have the capacity to help people outside a healthcare context. because you know it's not focused on pathology then, and people do actually start to look at exercising together or engaging together in a different way. So I don't think the answer solely lies in the formal healthcare system, and that we should really rethink about whether we should be focusing our efforts predominantly in that area.
I'm sorry if I implied that. I certainly didn't mean to.
No, I didn't. I'm just saying. It's a heartfelt thing from me about, I think, slightly moving the agenda out because of what the people's main concerns are about. Yeah. So in primary care, yes, people are looking at the biomedical outcomes of diabetes and heart disease, and that's what they should be focused on. To actually get people involved in complex negotiations about how to connect people up to resources, to start them on a journey of looking at preferences and how they might start to do more exercise or change their eating habits, is a lot to ask. So I'm just wondering whether, you know, we should be looking elsewhere to put our efforts into. That was all. It wasn't a critique of what you said.
Thank you. John, if obesity is the new smoking, what can we learn from the success, relatively speaking, of smoking cessation that might apply to tackling obesity, and what doesn't translate between the two, particularly, I think, in relation to the shift in public opinion that allowed legislation to be brought forward and accepted on a nationwide scale?
Well, I would maybe start, I'm sure there's a comment, John, and it sort of picks up the debate we were just having, actually, which is that I think in a lot of this area, part of the problem is that we do sometimes default to rather sort of stylized choices, dichotomies. You know, on the one hand, the total restructuring of, you know, economic responsibility and power in society versus kind of pull yourself together, Carruthers. And that unfortunately is how some of these debates. I think what we learn from smoking and from many of the other successes that we've had is it's layers of the onion. You've got to kind of tackle all layers of the onion, or said another way, it's a sort of all of the above approach. So yes, actually providing smoking cessation services, nicotine replacement, you know, controversially Public Health England have said that, you know, e-cigs are going to be a further contribution. I think, Michael, am I right in saying that half of the class life expectancy difference is still linked to differential smoking rates in this country?
It's a bit less.
Call it, I don't know, 40%. But, I mean, nevertheless, I mean, that's huge. So we've got, if you look at smoking during pregnancy, it's under 2% for women in Kensington and Chelsea, and it's 28%, I think, in Blackpool. I think it's the worst in the country. So, I mean, you kind of answered the question on some of these big risk factors. How have we tackled them? Yes, of course, there's a sort of individual element to this, but as you imply, John, it's also price, it's regulation, it's the progressive sequencing, it's an unfinished business, but, you know, smoking in public places, confined spaces, cars, I mean, that's a, you know, 30-year journey, 40-year journey, actually, isn't it?
So are we close to the point where the public would accept some form of legislation about sugar, for example?
I think so, yes.
Michael?
Well, and please don't forget the point that I made, that this has now become very clearly part of inequalities, that if you have a simple health education strategy, people of around the room, I'm not going to insult too many people, I can see hardly anyone who's obese in this room. People of high education figure it out. They know what they've got to do. They take control over their lives, and they can afford the healthy food and all those other things. And the reason I went on at length about Jimmy in Calton is you want Jimmy not to be overweight. Then you've got to deal with his social conditions.
I agree. That's one of the problems. You haven't got much to offer Jimmy in Glasgow at the moment.
Well, we've got a lot if we wanted to do it.
Not when he's 54.
No, not when he's 54.
So time is marching. I'm going to take three more questions now. There's two in the front and then there's one at the back. So
there's no doubt that the role of healthcare providers is changing. The panel have mentioned catalysing social partnerships, advocacy, enabling self-management of chronic diseases. So what's the role of the future healthcare professional, and how can Southampton, as a provider of medical education, change what we are sort of training the healthcare professionals of tomorrow to sort of enable them to help the patients of the future?
I don't mind starting.
Well, come Paul, on, Vice
Paul,
Dean.
Paul can add, but I mean, I think that the strong integration of the training structures for all of the health professional groupings has been a hallmark of our educational side over the years. The integration of behavioural approaches as part of the educational programmes, coupled with the underpinning biology, which we've tended to emphasise up until relatively recently. And I think, myself, an introduction to the philosophical principles which underlie much of the discourse that we've been hearing. So, in a society where we on the one hand want individual freedom, but on the other want social cohesion, How do we achieve that balance? What are the rules of engagement whereby we decide what constitutes the modifiable layer of Simon's onion, but what constitutes a layer that isn't sort of transcendent to being somehow a sort of turning back of the French Revolution? I think those are tractable subjects and discussions that ought to be had, and ones which actually are ideally placed in sort of health professional curricula. So that's the sort of thing I'd like to see.
Paul?
We're trying just as hard as we can in a crowded curriculum to introduce some of these concepts. The graduate students are a very rich source because they bring some maturity and other disciplinary background to the table. Likewise, our BM6 programme, people from disadvantaged backgrounds, first in education, first in university, are another malleable group where these issues echo their own experience. So there are new entrants into the medical curriculum that we can work with. And I think for following it through into postgraduate education, so my colleague Judy Park is trying to get some of these issues into postgraduate education, not just in public health training, but all clinicians training, having a public health perspective, I think is you know, one way forward.
Really, as an answer to a different question, but I can't avoid the opportunity to kind of plug it, which is that one of the really important things that the University of Southampton could do and its medical school is ensure that all of your medical undergraduates realise that there is no more professionally rewarding, intellectually stimulating, or socially impactful choice than choosing general practice for a career in medicine.
Well, thank you. That's a very clear steer. Another question.
Finally, Jagger Barrett Vala retired a long time ago. Slightly overweight. I can do something about that, you tell me. Something I can't, and the public can't do anything about, as things stand, is the environment. The Royal Commission on Environmental Pollution was, in fact, an organisation that was independent. Very, very intellectually able people on it. It's gone because it produced from time to time some uncomfortable findings. The environment, noise and pollution affects us all. Airport development is very much in the news. It affects children, and it's been shown by studies at Barts and the London that cognitive development suffers with noise. We know the effects of health on noise. The non-auditory effects, we now know, and there's accumulating evidence on the effects of the cardiovascular system. It's not been all brought together, but it's very much there. It wasn't 10 years ago. Now, development like airports or major industrial developments should have health impact assessments. The Department of Health said they should, but they're not done. And why not? One was done, it was so appalling when I saw it, I would reject it as a thesis. Now, the environment, those involved in education, those involved in agriculture, are all involved in this. But the voice which has not been heard is health. And I have challenged this on numerous occasions. And I've had letters back which have been bland or have not really understood the problems. Airport development, for example, is going to affect hundreds of thousands of people. And it's going to be all over the country in due course. And I think we should show a lead, because this is not going to occur only in this country, but all over the world. When is the Department of Health going to realize its obligations and not sit behind, in fact, commercial pressures, which it is in this sort of area? British Airports Authority, as it was, British Airways, have a mighty voice. Department of Health should have one which is as mighty as those.
Well, I feel the need to respond because I spent 6 years as a member of the Royal Commission on Environmental Pollution. So I think that the way forward is to recognise that what we were talking about on the Royal Commission was environment more usually conceived. But sustainable development has three pillars, which is the environment, the social, and the economic. I'm full of whales at the moment. Just as I say, I was in Cardiff. Ruth Hussey, who's chief medical officer of Wales for another month, 6 weeks, was instrumental in, I think, getting their sustainable development, what started off as a sustainable development initiative in Wales, to get health central. They now have, it's called sort of health and well-being for healthy futures or well futures or something for Wales. I don't know if you're familiar with it. And health is central, but so are these other two pillars of the social and economic. It's a cross-government mechanism. They've just appointed a commissioner who has responsibility to hold all government departments to account. It's a really very powerful mechanism. Now, I've been arguing with the various reviews and commissions that I did that we need not just health impact assessment, but health equity impact assessment. We need to look at all policies for their likely impact on health equity, not just the physical and biological environment, but the social environment as well. And this Wales body is a mechanism for doing that.
We finally need to move on to
if in fact these things are to be done, academia has a very important role because they're independent and they must make their voice felt.
Sure.
And they haven't really.
Thank you. Final question back, please.
Probably a good final point, actually. Sorry. I'm Mark Grill and I'm a GP in Lewisham and I've been a GP 38 years there, and I have to say it's the best job in the world, but it might need a little bit of tweaking just at the moment, Simon, if you don't mind. But yes, thank you. Yes. I also feel I've crashed your party slightly, so I'm sorry, because I'm actually chair of Lewisham and chair of the London CCGs rather than coming from the South Coast, but I was brought up in Poole. So I hope that might help a little.
You're very welcome.
Thank you very much. But in our area, we're doing everything we can in South East London, developing communities, doing all the work that you've talked about. And this just reinforces all that I know, and I'm delighted to hear all that and just wish I could implement it to make it happen more. But I feel we really only know when we succeed when I get called on a Sunday afternoon by Jeremy Hunt complaining that we have one of the worst obesity childhood levels in London, and why am I not doing something about it? And can
I'll arrange for Jeremy to give you a call.
If you can do that. I was going to say, when that happens...
Let's chat next week as to what fire in your belly that has created.
It would really make me work at it much harder. So I suppose what I mean by that is that we need the political incentive to make it really work. And rather than the focusing on whether my patients are, you know, or your patients, perhaps, are 5 minutes longer extra in casualty, we need these things to be working in order to make the transformative change that's required.
Would anyone like to pick up that?
Well, it's just very much on my mind. I was in Coventry lecturing.
Not Wales.
Not Wales. No, it's such a fun job I get about Coventry, you know, Leicester. It's such a fun job. I was in Coventry and a GP came up to me and I was talking about social determinants of health, improving society and so on. And a GP came up to me and he said, I just had a woman who died of lung cancer. And then he started to weep. He said, if only I could have done something about her smoking when she was a teenager. I knew her then. And we needed to take broader action to improve her condition so she might have seen the light and not smoked. And he was then saying to me, very moving, he was saying to me that this comes back to Sophie's question of how do you want to train the future doctors? The future doctors do have to address the conditions in which people are born, grow, live, work and age, because that impacts on the health of their patients. They can't just wait till they get sick. They've got to be agents for improving the conditions of people's lives.
Okay, I think that's a great position to finish on. First of all, could you please join me in thanking very much the five panellists, and particularly our guest speakers. I'd like to thank all of you for attending and contributing today. It's been a really good conversation. I think we should thank colleagues at the university who've done a lot of preparation to make today happen, because it's been a challenge from what I've seen. So well done to all you guys. And I hope we've given you a flavour of a really complex but important challenge, a challenge that's going to need a multidisciplinary approach. It's going to need universities to draw upon not just the medical and health sciences, but the physical sciences, the social sciences, and the behavioural sciences. It's going to need working across sectors, working with the NHS, working with social services and others. But it's a great opportunity and a great goal if we can do something about these big challenges. So thank you very much, and please now join us for a drinks reception.